tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you.
Good morning. Good morning and welcome to our worship. And indeed, come. We hope you've come just as you are. Whether you're gathered here in person or on our live stream as well, this is the third Sunday after the Epiphany, and we gather together. It's a special day for us, a special Sunday for us. Not only do we have the band playing for us, but after church, don't just sit in the back row and sneak off after church. We got breakfast for you. We'd love to have you stick around for a nice breakfast fellowship. Linda Kangas and Kathy Anderson have been busy slaving away down there. There'll be some beautiful egg-type bakes for you. And then we also want to gather together to do some work with our Sunday school ministry to get rooms in shape and things like that. It's kind of a mini God's work, our hands kind of Sunday dedicated for today. When you roll through the season of Epiphany, you have Jesus walking and teaching and preaching, performing miracles and revealing himself. That's what Epiphany means, the manifestation of Christ. And this morning is no different. We have that very familiar text in Matthew chapter 4. Many a Bible camp song has been done about this, Fishers of Men. And Jesus calling us to faith. And this morning's sermon theme, what we can learn from an atheist. Okay, all right. A couple of announcements before we continue our worship in earnest. The annual meeting next Sunday, another very special Sunday. The annual meeting reports are back there. Please do take one. Please do read it thoroughly, not during my wonderful sermon, of course, but you stick around and for maybe read it during the brunch time, the lunch or the breakfast time that we have, and take a look at all the wonderful things that are being done here at Our Savior's Lutheran Church. Best wishes to Gloria O'Brien, who will be celebrating her birthday on Saturday. Happy birthday to Gloria. Save the date, obviously, for the annual meeting next Sunday. And during the month of February, another wonderful, worthy tradition and a part of our culture here at Our Savior's Lutheran Church, the baby shower in February for those who would definitely benefit from some of those provisions. So if you're of an ilk to knit or to provide something for that particular effort, please do put that on your calendar. Yeah. So, those are the announcements as we have them. Let us continue our worship in earnest with our opening hymn, Here I Am to Worship. Please rise.
Light of the world, you stepped
indeed, Lord, you are worthy of all of these great attributes that we lay before you. We thank you for your love, your mercy, your grace that sustains us each and every day of our lives. We thank you, O Lord, for your abidance with us forever. You may be seated. Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit to be with you all.
And also with you.
We continue with the lesson.
A reading from Isaiah. There will be no gloom for those who were in anguish. In the former time, the Lord brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in the land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressors, you have broken as on the day of Midian. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Children's message time, I see. Come on down. Yeah, they're eager to get over here. For our radio audience, we got a good group of good-looking kids gathered around here. How you doing there, Evan? Take a seat. Yeah. Huh. How many know what this is?
A net.
A net. Yeah, once again, for our radio audience, I'm holding up a fishing net. And what do you do with a fishing net? Huh? What do you think?
Catch fish.
Catch fish, right? So you're reeling in a big lunker, and have you ever heard somebody say, get the net, get the net? And what does that usually mean? Get the net, right? Duh, Pastor Kevin. Well, it means it's a big fish, right? Yeah, it's not some small little sunny or crappie that you can just kind of toss in the boat. You need to get this big net to whoosh and bring it into the, net it to bring it into the boat. Yeah. Well, that's kind of how we fish, but there are a lot of fishermen that all they use is nets. Have you ever noticed that? And they cast them out. Right. Now, the lesson that Mr. Wilson is about to read for us a little bit later on talks about Jesus, and Jesus is gathering disciples, and guess who he saw? He saw some fishermen, and they were tending to their nets, they were mending them, they were getting ready for a day of fishing, okay? And Jesus said to them, come follow me, and I will make you, and there's different ways to word this, but I will make you fishers of men. What do you suppose Jesus meant by that? Anybody? What do you think? Fishers of men. Yeah.
Attract people to the word of God.
Right. Spot on. Attract people to the word of God or to the promises of God, right? Now, dear friends, there's no such thing as a perfect analogy. You take a net and you pull a fish out of the water. What happens to the fish eventually? It's going to die, right? Yeah, it'll make a meal for us and we'll live, of course, right? It's going to die. But you pull a searching soul out of this dark, fallen world, you pull that soul out with the figurative net, and the person lives, doesn't die. Yeah. Now, there's another piece that Mr. Wilson's going to read here, and it's a lovely word. It's a word and a lesson that I know that we have done more than once here at Our Savior's Lutheran Church. It has to deal with the word, it begins with an R. Repent. Repent. Now, I know I have taught you guys about repentance before. We have a little object lesson that we do. Can anybody remember what it is? Anybody? Yeah?
We ran out into the pews and then you said, repent, and we all ran back.
You got that right, sport, right? You all run back out into the pews. You guys are smart kids, right? You all run out down the aisle, yeah? And we say, repent! And what do you guys do? Y'all come back. That's literally what repentance means. Someday you guys are going to be old enough, and I'm going to have one of you give the children's message. Yes, not today, not tomorrow, but maybe 3 or 4 years from now. You could do it, and you could do the same lesson with younger kids like you are right now. But let's just practice that, and let's do it with the net. How about that? How should we do this? How should we figure this out? Repentance and the net. What do you think? Anybody got any ideas? Well, I suppose we could go out here and maybe net some of the people out there. No, we're not going to do that. They'd be too shy. How about we shoot ourselves down the aisle, and I say, repent, and I take this net, and I grab you, and we'll bring you back. How about that? Does that sound like fun?
No.
I thought you guys might find that really fun. No? Well, how about you do it to me? You want to do it that way? Oh, no. Okay, all right. Well, let's practice. Okay, stand up. Don't be bashful, okay? I want you to scatter now. You're wandering away. You're fish that are going deep, deep into the sea. Oh, look at AJ. He's really running. Repent! Repent! Come on back! Repent! Come follow me, and I will make you fishers of men, right? Yep. There's a Bible camp song that goes like that, too. I will make you fishers of men. You know that one? Oh, I'll teach you. It's very easy. I will make you fishers of men, fishers of men, fishers of men. I will make you fishers of men if you follow me, if you follow me, if you follow me. I will make you fishers of men if you follow me. Little off tune, we didn't even have time to practice that. All right, guess what I have in here? These are candies known as Swedish fish, okay? Now, they're meant to obviously illustrate what Mr. Wilson's about to read. And I got a big bag of Swedish fish here, all right? What I want you to do now is I want you to take a handful of these Swedish fish, and when Mr. Wilson gets to reading the lesson, and when he gets to the point where Jesus says, I will make you fishers of men, I want you, okay, if mom or dad say that it's okay, I want you to take that little fish and eat it, okay? I will make you fishers of men. And then I'm giving you enough so that you can share. Who do you suppose you might share that Swedish fish with? Mom, dad, grandpa, and grandma, whoever's here, right? Okay, all right, so go ahead. Let's get handfuls here, okay? All right, got that, got this. Come on over here, don't be shy, don't be shy. Okay, got a few there. Get your little mitts out here. Okay, there you go, there you go. Okay, everybody got one? All right. I will make you fishers of men. Everybody got one?
One right there.
Is there one right there? Did I drop one? Okay. Yeah, when it comes to Jesus and making fishers of men, the net breaks open. Yeah, there's just too many. Okay. All right, let's close with a word of prayer, shall we? Gracious and loving God, you call us back to you. To love and to serve. May we always hear your promise to be fishers of men. We love you, Lord Jesus. All right, now go back to your seats. And if mom and dad give you permission, go ahead and eat that at the appropriate time. All right, probably going to get in trouble with mom and dad on that one. Okay, hey, please rise for the reading of the gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea across the Jordan. Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen great light. And for those who sat in the region in the shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. And he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. We begin with a little levity. A Christian woman, upon waking up each morning, would open her front door and stand on the porch and yell, "Praise the Lord!" This infuriated her atheist neighbor, who would always make sure to counter back, "There is no Lord, there is no God." One morning, the atheist neighbor overheard the Christian neighbor praying for food. Thinking it would be funny, the atheist neighbor brought her all sorts of groceries and left them on her front porch. The next morning, the lady once again proclaimed, "Praise the Lord who gave me all this food." The neighbor, laughing so hard he could barely get the words out, screamed, "It wasn't the Lord, it was me." The Christian lady, without missing a beat, said, "Praise the Lord for not only giving me food, but having the atheist pay for it." Which begs the question, I often wonder, are atheists doing the will of God and they're not even aware of it? Moreover, what is so ironic about atheists is that they like to talk so much about the God they don't believe in. In my line of work, I obviously speak with a lot of people about God. And on occasion, I will talk with an atheist or two. Or at the very least, someone who has a lot of questions about the existence of God or what the existence of God might look like in such a fallen world that we live in. And in all the conversations I have had with atheists and others about God, there are two thoughts that have come to surface. Number one, tell me about the God you don't believe in. I might not believe in that God either. And number two, I personally believe in a God who doesn't believe in atheists. I firmly believe this, that somehow, some way, God will get through. I believe in a God who doesn't believe in atheists, that the relentless nature of the cross of Christ will permeate all darkness into God's magnificent light. I believe in a God who doesn't believe in atheists, that the transforming, comforting, cajoling, and shepherding nature of God will eventually win out. And God might be using each of you to get this done.
even the self-proclaimed atheist, to be doing God's work. Repent, says our Lord Jesus to the people in Galilee, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. And guess what, dear friends? It keeps coming again and again and again, expanding and expanding all over. People need to hear this. And you want to know something? I firmly believe that somewhere deep in everyone's heart, people want to hear this. They really do. I think especially the atheists. You might be surprised to learn that many people become atheists not because they are hearing a strong message of spiritual change, but because they are hearing something less than that. Perhaps atheists don't want less Christianity. They want a more serious, dedicated, committed version of it. I have often heard people tell me that I don't necessarily have a problem with Christ, but I do have a problem with some of his followers. Ooh, that's convicting. Perhaps what the atheist is looking for is for each one of us to get a little bit more fired up about our faith. Huh? Young people in particular, who have turned away from God, or at least the God that we have tried to teach them about in church and Sunday school, young people are often looking for the light first prophesied by Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 9, which Lauren just so eloquently read this morning. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. For those who have sat in the region in the shadow of death, light has dawned. Dr. Kendra Creasy Dean is an ordained United Methodist pastor who has written extensively about passing on Christian faith to our children and evangelizing towards the youth of America. In her book, Almost Christian, What the Faith of Our Teenagers is Telling the American Church, Dr. Dean writes as follows. The problem does not seem to be that churches are teaching young people badly, but that they are doing an exceedingly good job of teaching youth what we really believe, namely that Christianity is not a big deal, that God requires very little of us, and the church is a helpful social institution filled with nice people focused primarily on folks like us, which of course begs the question of whether we are really the church at all, says Dr. Dean. What if the blasé religiosity of most American teenagers is not the result of poor communication, but the result of excellent communication, of a watered-down gospel so devoid of God's self-giving love in Jesus Christ, so immune to the sending of the love of the Holy Spirit that might not be Christianity at all? What if the church models a way of life that asks not passionate surrender, but ho-hum assent? What if we are preaching moral affirmation, feel better faith, and a hands-off God instead of being decisively involved, impossibly loving, radically sending the God of Abraham and Mary, who desired us enough to enter creation in Jesus Christ and whose spirit is active in the church and in the world today? Wow. If you don't feel convicted by those words, I know I sure do. For in over 30 years of ministry, I too have probably fallen victim a time or two, modeling blasé Christianity to my own children and to many a confirmand under my instruction, that Christianity really doesn't require that much of us. And so, Once again, I need to hear these words from our Savior. Repent, Kevin, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. Repent. So what can an atheist teach us about the gospel, this good news our Savior is calling us to repent towards? For starters, let's be clear about the Christian mission and message. For Jesus certainly was. As Jesus begins his ministry, the Gospel of Matthew says that he goes to Capernaum by the Sea of Galilee precisely because Jesus sees his mission as fulfillment of Isaiah chapter 9. On the road, by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. It was a forgotten place. It was a forgotten land. Out in the hinters, where nobody really cared about anything or anyone. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region in the shadow of death, light has dawned. How many people in your life need to hear that exact promise? How many people who are very close to you probably need to hear that commitment? Maybe a daughter or a son. Maybe a child. Someone who you are very close to. Maybe a brother or a brother-in-law. Jesus moves to Capernaum by the sea so that the people sitting in darkness can see a great light. He begins his ministry with a focus on replacing the shadow of death with the light of life. We need this light today, goes without saying. The darkness of despair still needs to be replaced by the light of hope. Ignorance enlightened by insight. Addictions overcome by self-control. Illness overpowered by healing. Isolation eliminated by community. For each of us has some dark corners of our lives. Places where we feel hopeless, sinful, lost, overwhelmed, and alone. But when the great light of Christ begins to shine, we move from darkness into a new day. Next, I truly do wonder if atheists remind us to keep Christ closely connected to real life. What's real? Reflecting on her experience in church, one study speaks of a college student named Stephanie, who said, "The connection between Jesus and a person's life was not clear for me. Our preaching and our teaching, yours and mine, must make a strong link between the life we live today and the life of Jesus Christ. We each struggle with sin and Jesus' forgiveness. We wander in confusion and need Jesus' clarity. We take actions grounded in ignorance as individuals and communities. In short, we need the light of Christ. We will continue to lose young people unless we proclaim the message of Christ and allow his light to shine on every aspect of our human life. I am encouraged and buoyed by the Sunday school resurgence that we have here in this time and place at our Savior's. But we need to build on that flame and on that fire. We need to encourage our young people at every age and to get them to understand this light of Christ." Atheists also teach us to offer thoughtful answers to life's difficult questions. Atheists and believers alike want thoughtful and compassionate conversation on hot button items such as evolution versus creationism, human sexuality, and the reliability of the biblical texts. They want us to open into an honest conversation of where we might be divided and where we might argue, but to do so in a spirit where there is love and compassion and understanding, that we can agree to disagree without being disagreeable. that we can welcome all who are even different than us, wherever that might be. The LGBTQ community, people of color, people who have been hurt in Native American lands. The gospel needs to be an open door. We might be different. We might have all sorts of differences, but we are united in the love of being fishers of people. Jesus certainly did this when he called his first disciples along the banks of the Sea of Galilee. Jesus probably could have picked all sorts of problems with Peter and John and Andrew and the disciples. They were not perfect people, and neither are you or neither am I. But he sees two fishermen, brothers, Simon, Peter, and Andrew, casting their net into the sea. Jesus says to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." How many of us need to hear that again? In the simplicity of who we are and how we are created in the image of God. Immediately, they leave their nets and follow Jesus. Jesus is bold enough to walk up to two complete strangers and challenge them to follow him in a life of discipleship. He cannot control their response, neither can we. But he believes in what he is doing, and he is willing to act on his beliefs. So too are we. They sense that he is authentic and committed to his mission, that they drop their nets and follow him. The word of Jesus, the promise of the Christ, creates a new reality: discipleship. Then, to prove that this is no fluke, Matthew tells that Jesus sees two other brothers, James and John, in a boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. He calls them, and immediately they leave the boat and their father and follow Jesus. I often wonder what the father Zebedee might have thought about that. Are you leaving the family business? What's going on here? So Jesus now is 4 for 4 in terms of succeeding in getting people to follow him, with the boldness of reaching out. The passage ends with Matthew telling us Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. Christ is no charlatan. He is entirely consistent in word and deed. Our Jesus teaches and preaches about the kingdom of God. His authenticity inspires people to follow him, and then his disciples recruit others to follow as well. With the power of the Holy Spirit, we can and we need to invite others to follow the Christ in the train of the faith that has been laid before us. And why should we not be excited with the prospect? It is and always will be God's work, our hand. The light of Christ has come into our lives, and we should never hide it from others. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Jesus has called each of us to follow and to fish for people. We are being complacent, perhaps even cruel, if we don't share our excitement about Christ and the life of the discipleship with others. An atheist, by definition, does not believe in God. But we follow a God, dear friends, who doesn't believe in atheists. The world is waiting. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region of the shadow of death, light has dawned. Let us continue in prayer as we invite the band to come forward. Gracious and loving God, we thank you so much for the gift of Christ, the light which shines in our darkness. Inspire in us that excitement, that faith, to do your work while it is day, till that night comes when no one can work. Allow it always to be, O Lord, God's work, our hands. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Seated. And just another word of reminder that the Apostles' Creed is very much entwined in the phrase that we are about to sing, "This I Believe." Notice all three aspects of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as we confess and sing our faith.
Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son. suffered and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light, forever seated high. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son.
Please rise. Together we join in intercessory prayer. Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Make your church one in purpose, O Lord, proclaiming the message of the cross. Help us to work together across differences. Energize ecumenical partnerships, including the World Council of Churches, the Lutheran World Federation, our Northeastern Minnesota Synod, and all areas where we can reach out to help those in need. We pray for Project CARE, the Salvation Army, Boys and Girls Clubs of America, and AEOA, the United Way. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to labor in your holy name and to bear witness to your love by what we say and do. We thank you for the fellowship and service and opportunity that is ours here at Our Savior's Lutheran Church. And later on this morning, God's work our hands in organizing our Sunday school rooms and resources and the teaching of our children. We also ask that you would bless the breakfast fellowship that we have after worship this morning. Merciful God, abundant Lord, we know that your love is infinite and that you care about all areas of our life. In this time of economic insecurity and our church budget shortfall, help us to trust that all our security is in you. Keep us mindful that you always have and always will provide for our needs. Apart from you, we can do nothing. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Gracious God, in Christ, your reign comes near and calls us to repentance. Break the rod of oppressors in every nation. Dispel the shadow of death in places of war and persecution. Particularly this day, we pray for the people of Ukraine and other areas of the world where there is armed conflict from oppression. Grant us leaders who lift the yokes that burden those in need. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Almighty and merciful God, you are the only source of health and healing. You alone can bring calmness and peace. Grant to us, your children, an awareness of your presence and strong confidence in you. In our pain, our weariness, and our anxiety, and our anxiousness to be restored back to health, surround us with your care, protect us by your loving might, and permit us once more to enjoy health and strength and peace. This day we pray for those who have requested prayer, for Dan Jordan, Sandy Olson, Sylvia Penn, Bonnie McDonald, Jan Hunter, Rich Foss, Sharon Waman, Jason Schlesner, Floyd Gorman, and all of those whom we silently name in our hearts at this time. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We bring to you our needs and our hopes, O Lord, trusting your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you all. Please share the Lord's peace. Please be cognizant of people who may be leery and concerned of COVID and keep appropriate boundaries as is warranted. Frank, peace be with you. Peace be with you. Yes, peace. The offering will be received. Please be seated. Please rise. Join me in prayer. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love. Through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom as you yourself have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction of our Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look down upon you with favor in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. How great is our God. Once again, stick around for breakfast, and I think after breakfast they'll put you to work doing something over there in those Sunday school rooms. I haven't heard what that is all entails, but stick around and we'll put you to work and you'll do wonderful things here at this church. Go in peace, serve the Lord. Let's give this band a nice round of applause too, shall we? And they're going to give us a very lovely postlude.
Soon and very soon, we are
soon, and very soon.